Dear learners, welcome to NIOS course on sociology at senior secondary level. I, Dr. Rajalakshmi from Janaki Devi Memorial College, Delhi University, today will be discussing a very important topic, national integration concept and challenges. Our nation, India, is a great nation. It's not only because of its geographical entity, it's a body of people sharing the sentiments of belongingness. When I say that our India is unique in terms of its geographical entity, what I mean is from the north, we are covered with Himalayas. So therefore, it gives a very unique culture and environment to it. Then we are surrounded by three big oceans. Therefore, the culture again gives and the sentiments people who belong there again reflect a very unique culture. Now, what exactly do we mean by national integration? It's very important for our students to first understand the concept. Now, the concept as such refers to feeling of oneness, which is not only imposed by any authority, like maybe the constitutional authority or maybe the political entity, but also it's a thought, feeling and action in this regard, which comes from within, that is from our own minds, from own self. A kind of belongingness is what towards the nation is what is national integration. It is a feeling of unity within diversity. Now, we all know that India is a land of diversities. Now, if we actually look at the whole concept, how it started during the history or before we gained independence, we could say that roughly when the kings ruled, one of the greatest kings which almost covered the entire India, I would say almost, not the entire India, but majority of India, was great Ashoka the Emperor. He tried uniting India geographically. While uniting that geographically, he also kept in mind that people do follow the same kind of unity in terms of their approach, sentiments, religious, cultural aspects. So therefore, he tried constructing many, many smaller kingdoms into one. Then we have the next, the Mughals who came to India. And one of their basic aim was not only to conquer, but also try to see that all the people are integrated under one kingdom. So the policies, the programs which they came up forward did bring about a kind of unity. And at that time, there was a unity among the Hindus and Muslims. They did try to unite them because a lot of people who were the serving classes at that time converted to Hinduism, or you could say converted to Islam, you know, because the Mughals came and tried spreading the Islamic beliefs and practices. As a result, we do see that sentiment-wise, somewhere there was a unity. Then India gained independence, but before India gained independence, one of the major works which was done by the reformers was that they tried bringing about the social evils which were present at that time. Now, once the social evils came up, education started gaining a lot of significance. With education, what happened was people started getting united. In the sense, just before the independence, the time, the era of reformers, the social reformers, when they started working towards the social evils which were prevalent at that time, a lot of people, the intelligentsias, people who had a similar ideology, people who wanted to make or a difference in the society, who wanted to make India free from any kind of social evils, came forward, united, and then started fighting against the social evils. That is the intelligentsia, the intellectuals, and the social reformers who were directly affected by the plight of the local people, which included both men and women. Then there came the era of Britishers, when they started looking at India as a market for their raw materials, and they wanted to see India as their place where they could spread their ideas. So therefore, they also started concentrating on education. And in turn, in order to bring the various parts of India as one subcontinent, geographically, they were all united. In the sense, with the help of railways, the different states were united. With the help of the posters, the ideas could go from one end to the other end. As a result, what happened was a lot of people tried to understand the Indian national struggle from the Marxian point of view, which says that it was a union of opposites where the Indians, the nationalists, felt that the British were exploiting the Indians, whereas other way what happened was that the British did try to unite India as one big nation through the construction of railways, improvement of postal services, and also by trying to communicate the ideas from one end to the other. And education at that time played a very important role. Lot of Christian missionaries came forward. They started looking started working with the downtrodden. As a result, we do see that India was united in terms of geographical unity, political unity, so that the policies and the programs of the Britishers could go to every corner of India. Then came the independence. After independence, we do see that Jawaharlal Nehru, the one who had a strong socialist belief, wanted to unite, and he did work towards the with the laborers and towards uniting the labor force. As a result, a lot of trade unions were formed. So the working class united. Mahatma Gandhi united the masses, which was very, very important. And around the same time, B.R. Ambedkar ji, what he did was that he tried uniting the downtrodden, the SC, the SCs. So therefore, with the Dalit communities, he worked and brought all the Dalits together. As a result, the different classes in India came as united class, and the class structure was formed, which became very, very vibrant over the years. Now, this was a sort of a political, the social unity. The cultural unity, obviously, what had happened was that a lot of anthropologists at that time started understanding the Indian society and felt that India is united in their belief in the caste system. Now, the caste system, one way or the other, unites people, though they are placed in different regions. That is, we will talk about the diversities later. But as a collective sentiments of the people, people are united in India in terms of their caste feelings. That is, the caste governs, it's a skin deep, and caste feelings are there in everybody's mind. Though actually there is a Varna system which is mentioned in the Rig Veda, but the functional aspect is the caste system. And though there are many sub-caste and then sub-caste, also sub-caste, which can be regionally spelt out, which we will discuss when we talk about the question of diversities. However, the national integration, which is a very positive belief and very essential for the progress, development, both socially and culturally in the society, is something which today is facing a challenge. What I would say is that, before we go to the way in which it is facing challenges, as we said, that the chapter basically talks about the concepts. We must be very clear about certain concepts which I just mentioned. That is a concept of development. Development is something which people to get together, plan a progress in a systematic manner. So that it called a development. Then it's called a development. That is something which is planned out. Social, we all know, is something which happens within the society, and positive is something which we all believe in it and we all do it. So there is a consensus among the people who belong to the same nation that they should have a strong sense of national integrity or integration. However, as I said, that today in the contemporary India, we are facing a lot of challenges. Challenges would mean that there are negative forces which are acting. So we have the positive forces on one side, we have the negative forces. So we need to first understand what exactly are these negative forces which are acting as a challenge to our nation. One is, of course, extremism. That is, some sections of the society, it is very difficult to name, because India is a land of, to begin with, 8 religions. Now some religions have gone out of India, but at one point of time, India was a land of 8 religions. To name Hinduism, Christianity, Islam, Sikhism, Buddhism, Jainism, Zoroastrianism, and we also have a community which is referred to as Parsis community. However, all these have an extreme, some of these religious groups are very extreme in thought process, that what happens is in a multi-religious and multicultural society like ours, sometimes instead of uniting, there are incidences where people tend to develop extreme feeling of fundamentalism, which can cause conflict in the society. Now, this conflict sometimes sociologists say is positive and it's essential for change, but sometimes it may lead to a certain kind of disunity which may harm the other society as a whole or a nation as a whole. Terrorism. Now, terrorism again is something which is very, very difficult to actually understand, because a terrorist could be a terrorist one group or maybe a national leader for the other group. The group to which he belongs, to the nation, the son of the soil for which he is fighting, for him, he could be a freedom fighter, but for the others against whom he is fighting could be a terrorist. But however, in India, in the recent past, we are facing a lot of terrorism, or rather you can say terrorist sentiments, which could lead to a very, very harmful thing for the nation as a whole. Now, if you go according to different aspects which are becoming a challenge, is one challenge, one among them is regionalism. Now, what exactly is regionalism? Regionalism is a feeling of pride and loyalty that people belonging to one region have. That is the concept of sons of the soil. I am born into this region. I'm from this region. So therefore, my region is better than the others. Sometimes this feeling creates a sense of ethnocentrism, which becomes very, very harmful in the long run. And we in the nation, in one nation, sometimes do feeling a very, very strong sense of we feeling in relation to our region. Now, in India, we have almost 29 states and there are 7 union territory, which includes the national capital of Delhi, which is of course a semi-state, not a state in its full sense. Now, Telangana, as we all know, is the newest state in India, which was formed on 2nd June 2014 with Hyderabad as its capital. Now, Andhra Pradesh now has a new capital, which is called Amaravati, and there's another capital, which is Hyderabad. Why am I mentioning this is mainly because with so many regions, so many geographical boundaries, each region has got its own culture, has got its own terminology, the kingship terminology and the kingship practices. To very broadly tell that in North, when we talk about the marriage rules, there are very, very excluding, that is, one should not get married within one's own exogamy. Village also says that one should not get married between the 7 generations from the father's side and from the... Whereas if you go down south, nation is one, but if you go down south, there is cross-cousin marriage and there is uncle and niece marriage also. And because of these differences in the kingship practices, what happens is the marriage rules are also different. The kingship terminology also is very different. So which makes that each region is unique. Plus also, if you see that the way, though we say that sari is some dress which is worn by every woman in India, but the way the sari is worn, the textile which is used again is unique from state to state. And some states produce such unique fabric, which of course today has become, which has become a national one, or it has been accepted by other states. There's a lot of mixing up of this, but each state in terms of its ethnic identity is very unique. When I say ethnic identity, it includes food, it includes the dress pattern, it includes kinship practices, the marriage rules, and of course, the way in which the caste operates. When I say the way in which the caste operates, if you remember, I said that caste as a sentiment unifies people together. That is, in India, everybody believes in the caste system. But The caste, when it is practiced in various regions, of course, changes its character. It changes character mainly because of the concept of dominant caste, which M.N. Srinivas has given us. Now, the dominant caste refers to the dominance in terms of economic, political and social dominance, which makes people unique, and there is a differentiation. The another point of challenge is our language. Now, 8th schedule of the Indian Constitution lists 22 languages, which have been referred to as scheduled languages and given recognition, status and official encouragement. In addition, the government of India has awarded the distinction of classical languages to Kannada, Malayalam, Odia, Sanskrit, Tamil and Telugu. So you can imagine with 22 languages, how difficult it is to bring people together. However, the unity is seen that the Indian Constitution accepts in many states, and in fact, the most of the states, the three language formula, which is English as an official or the written language, Hindi as some spoken language, and the third, that is the regional language. Now, one of the sociologists by the name of Iravati Karve, she says the unique distinction of Indian culture is that it is identified by three things. One, the family structure. Two, the caste system. And third, the most important, language. Because it's a language which binds people together. It's a language which brings a sense of we feeling among people, and it tries to distinguish between us and them. So language plays a very important role, and within India, with so many languages, sometimes it tends to create a kind of rift between the groups, mainly because of the concept of us and them feeling. And that's why many times we do witness that when you go to South, people do not want to accept the Aryan language, which they feel is a Hindi language. So there is a third language formula practiced. Now, another major challenge to our national integration is communalism. Now, what is this communalism? It is placing one's own community above others, even above the nation. As I mentioned earlier, that India being a multi-religious state or a country, where in the constitution, it is very clearly mentioned that India is a secular state. When we say secular state, unlike the West, which tries to keep religion away from politics, in India, religion and politics are seen one and the same. It's mainly because India has been a multi-religious, and India has a lot of, invaders, invasions, and a lot of foreign people who came and ruled. So for many years, when India was ruled by the outsiders, the outsiders' influence were also seen, and many religions came up, and India became a host to multi-religious sentiments or people around us. And that brought about the major challenge to India in terms of communalism, which is people having a strong religious sentiments. Now, if you look at the other aspects of India as a whole nation, apart from language, which we discuss, religion, region, the caste system, the family system, which also tries to show a different pattern. So many a times what happens is when people shift from south to north or from east to west because of differences in their racial patterns, because again in India we have almost 7 to 9 racial communities or groups. So therefore with the race, what happens is the physical features also show differences. So many a times what happens is because they are races, different races, because they are different caste, because India is a vast country in terms of its geography, plus also, as I mentioned, that it is administrative purpose divided into various states. So all these things become a big, huge challenge to India. But however, India with its one constitution, India with its directive principles, India with its fundamental rights has been showing a lot of unity among the people. So India is a unique nation which hosts, population-wise, all of us know that it's one of the leading nations in the world in terms of its population. So to keep all these people together is a big challenge. However, the challenges which of course internally it faces is being handled by the Planning Commission in terms of its programs and policies. It has been handled by the political parties, where periodically they have 5-year elections where the people choose their leaders. So therefore, India, somewhere down the line, is showing a great unity. Thank you.